Wrestlers were once renowned for being world travelers, picking up bits and pieces of different styles from each place they went to, and weaving the different cultures together in the form of a wrestling match. American sports entertainment is an entirely different beast from Japanese strong style or British catch. In turn, these can be almost unrecognizable when compared to lucha libre, death matches, or even North American indie wrestling. With the rise of WWE, a lot of these styles used to get lost in the West, as wrestlers were often filtered through the company's developmental system at a young age, rarely having the opportunity to see what else was available. However, one man who has kept the tradition alive is Finn Balor. Born in Ireland, he grew up on British wrestling, although he really started to come into his own while training in Japan, developing much of his in-ring style based on what he learned over there. Since then, he's done excursions in Mexico, and eventually came to America, picking up all those different styles on his journey to the mainstream. Having these tools at his disposal has made him a rare talent in the modern age, one who can do almost anything. So, let's take a deep dive into his fascinating entire career journey to where he is today, in Real Rock and Rolla, the Finn Balor Story. Fergal Devitt was born on July 25, 1981 in Bray County, Wicklow, Ireland. He found an early passion in sports, getting involved in both Gaelic and association football as a young man. Like our other subjects, though, he was eventually bitten by the wrestling bug, having grown up watching World of Sport and WWE on Irish television, where his favorite performers included Shawn Michaels, Mr. Perfect, and the British Bulldogs. He first started training while still a teenager, learning his craft at NWA UK Hammerlock. Once his training was finished, he made his in-ring debut for the promotion in 2000, quickly becoming their heavyweight champion after that. With this early success fueling him, he began touring the world, working in not only Ireland, but the UK, America, and Japan as well. During these early years, he built up quite a reputation for himself, not only as a great in-ring wrestler, but also as someone who understood the pageantry of the wrestling, often cosplaying as his favorite comic book characters when coming out to the ring. This was something he continued throughout his entire career on the indies, with some of his most memorable looks being his full Venom body paint and Heath Ledger Joker costumes. It's also worth noting that he helped train a young Rebecca Quinn during this time. Quinn, of course, would later go on to become one of the biggest stars in wrestling in her own right, as Becky Lynch. With the look and the talent to back it up, Devitt was now an indie sensation. Taking notice of the name that he was building for himself, New Japan Pro Wrestling invited him to join their American dojo on August 8, 2005. To say this was an honor was an understatement. The New Japan Dojo has long been considered one of the most prestigious places to train as a wrestler in the world, and the American branch was no different. Upon starting, he quickly impressed his teachers, who promptly reported back east to their bosses about the superstar they had on their hands. This led to Devitt getting an invite to move over to the main dojo in Tokyo in early 2006. There, he honed his craft until it was laser sharp, soaking up everything he could so as to build on his already impressive knowledge of wrestling technique. While he did continue doing indie appearances in Europe and the US after starting his training, Japan would now become his home for the next 8 years. He would even move there, becoming fully immersed in the culture that he had been a big fan of since he was a young man, while he worked hard to impress his tutors every day. After graduating from the Tokyo Dojo, Devitt signed a contract with New Japan Pro Wrestling in March 2006, and a month later, he made his in-ring debut against El Samurai. While there was a brief period early on in his run where he wrestled as the Pegasus Kid, he was soon going by the moniker of Prince Devitt instead. He has since explained the name change as being necessary due to people in Japan having difficulty pronouncing Fergal. He had originally planned to call himself King Devitt, but there was some internal debate within the company as to whether a 24-year-old was too young to be a king, so Prince was decided upon as a compromise. In ring, he quickly established himself as a star of the future, and it didn't take long before he was pushed to the next level with a heel turn, joining the counter-terrorism unit stable. Although initially he was portrayed more as the bratty runt of the group who wasn't fully accepted, he eventually gained the respect of his teammates, and it was hoped by them that he would be their shining star in years to come. This was supposed to begin at the June 2007 Best of the Super Juniors tournament, where Devitt entered as a hot prospect. In the end, though, he scored 0 points, disappointing not only the rest of CTU, but himself as well. Not to be defeated, he licked his wounds and formed a new group called Rise with former CTU stablemate Minoru. This alliance proved to be more fruitful for both of them, and by January 27, 2008, they had solidified their success by winning the IWGP Junior Heavyweight Tag Team titles. Over the course of the next year, Devitt and Minoru would become two-time champions, eventually losing the belts to No Limit, the team of Tetsuya Naito and Yujiro Takahashi. This didn't slow the Irishman down, though. He simply formed another new team, this time with Ryusuke Taguchi. The two named themselves Apollo 55, and on July 5, 2009, they became IWGP Tag Team Champions too, this marking Devitt's third overall reign. On May 30, 2009, he once again entered the Best of the Super Juniors tournament, this time faring much better than before, and making it all the way to the finals, where he was finally defeated. He would find continued success in the 2009 Super J Cup, and would even get to successfully defend his tag team titles with Taguchi at Wrestle Kingdom 4. Now, on the roll of his career, he made his third attempt at success in the 2010 Best of the Super Juniors tournament, and this time would be victorious, beating Kota Ibushi in the finals to earn a shot at Naomichi Marufuji's IWGP Junior Heavyweight title. That title shot came on June 19, 2010 at Dominion, where Devitt was successful in taking home the belt after pinning Marufuji in just over 20 minutes. He spent the rest of 2010 basking in his success. When he entered the annual G1 Climax tournament for the first time that year, he was now a double champion, holding both the singles and tag team junior titles. Despite still being portrayed as a junior heavyweight, usually lower down on the pecking order than heavyweights, he had an impressive run in the G1, racking up 4 wins out of a possible 7, and even defeating New Japan's ace, Hiroshi Tanahashi. On September 3, 2010, he successfully defended his junior heavyweight title against Kenny Omega. However, this would lead to Omega and his Golden Lovers teammate Kota Ibushi challenging and defeating Devitt and Taguchi for the junior tag team titles at Destruction on October 11th, much to the Irishman's disappointment. He now only had one belt again, and Devitt continued to defend this as if it was his baby, beating Ibushi at Wrestle Kingdom 5 in one of the best matches of either man's career at the time. He was even able to take the title stateside, where he defeated Low Ki at Invasion Tour 2011. He would hold on to it until the June 18th Dominion show, in fact, where he would find himself once again on the opposite side of the ring from Kota Ibushi, this time losing the match and seeing his reign end at 364 days. No longer the champion, Devitt instead focused on making the junior heavyweight division shine around the world, going on excursion to Mexico's CMLL promotion, where he would rack up excellent performance after excellent performance, adding the Lucha influence to his arsenal. By the end of 2012, he would be back with New Japan and would regain all the division's gold, becoming not only a 3-time junior heavyweight champion, but a 6-time junior tag team champion. Soon though, Devitt's Apollo 55 tag team partner Ryusuke Taguchi felt like it was his time to step up and become the face of the junior division. He challenged his teammate to a match for the title at the February 10, 2013 New Beginning, where the champion was able to retain. Soon after this, Devitt began portraying a more cocky character, regularly disrespecting both his partners and opponents. After Apollo 55 lost their junior tag team titles when were unsuccessful in their attempt to regain them at April 7th's Invasion attack, the Irishman turned on his teammate and debuted a new heavy in Bad Luck Fale, rechristening himself as the Real Rock and Roller in the process. Taguchi would try to get revenge at May 3rd's Wrestling Dontaku, but he was unable to overcome the new team of Devitt and Fale. Their ranks would be further bolstered later that night when Carl Anderson and Tama Tonga joined them to attack Hiroshi Tanahashi after his match, signaling the birth of the Bullet Club. In the current day, the Bullet Club has reached the point of becoming one of wrestling's most long-running and successful stables, surviving through a variety of different eras and leadership changes. In its original incarnation, it was conceived as a group where villainous foreigners, or gaijin, could come together, bringing Western tropes to New Japan wrestling, such as regularly interfering in matches, something which was considered sacrilegious to many traditional Japanese fans. Devitt used this new allegiance to shoot himself up to the heavyweight division, and here he would portray himself as something of a mafia don, often coming out to the ring hoisted up on the shoulders of his underboss Fale. The name Bullet Club was devised as a play on Carl Anderson's machine gun moniker, as well as Devitt's real shooter title, something which he had started using backstage as a way to playfully tease legitimate MMA pioneer and all-around terrifying human being, Minoru Suzuki. Of course, the Bullet Club quickly became a phenomenon in New Japan and drew the attention of a lot of Western fans as well. the group drew frequent comparisons to the NWO, something which they were only happy to add to by frequently throwing up the Too Sweet hand sign before and after their matches. As they continued to bolster their ranks, adding the likes of the Young Bucks and Doc Gallows, their leader was finding more and more success as a heavyweight. He won the 2013 Best of the Super Juniors tournament, then went on to challenge Kazuchika Okada for the IWGP Heavyweight Championship, hoping to be the first man to hold both junior and heavyweight world titles at the same time. While Devitt was not successful in this attempt when the match happened on July 20th of that year, he was able to get a measure of revenge when, with the help of some interference from his Bullet Club teammates, he was able to defeat Okada on the first day of the 2013 G1 Climax. He followed this up with wins against three other former IWGP Heavyweight Champions, Hiroshi Tanahashi, Satoshi Kojima, and Togi Makabe. Soon after this, he started feuding once more with Kota Ibushi. This, and their now years-long rivalry as a whole, would reach its climax at Wrestle Kingdom 8 on January 4th, 2014, where in an absolute classic bout, Devitt's 14-month reign as IWGP Junior Heavyweight Champion finally came to an end. From here, his old tag partner Ryusuke Taguchi returned for his revenge, leading to a grudge match between the two at April 6th Invasion Attack, where in a shock to the audience, Devitt was betrayed by his Bullet Club teammates, the Young Bucks, getting kicked out of the very stable he had started the next day, only to be replaced by AJ Styles, but that's a topic of another video we've already done elsewhere on this channel. On screen, the reason for this betrayal was that his teammates had lost faith in his ability to be a leader after losing his junior heavyweight title. Off screen, however, the breakup came out of necessity, as Devitt had announced he was leaving New Japan to join WWE. It was certainly bittersweet for him. Japan had been his home for almost a decade, and was the place where he had learned much of his craft. Still, he had new goals ahead of him, so he said his farewells and set off to America, where on October 23, 2014, he made his debut on NXT, being introduced as a teammate for Hideo Itami to help him take on the Ascension. Devitt now went by the name Finn Balor, Finn being a reference to Finn McCool, a mythical Irish warrior, with Balor a nod to the Gaelic Demon King of the same name. Finn quickly made an impact, rising up the ranks to the spot of number one contender for the world title in only a few months. He would further wow fans by bringing the body paint that he had become so famous for on the indies and during his later run in NJPW to the yellow and gold brand, effectively giving himself a kayfabe power-up by doing so. One of these occasions came during his NXT heavyweight title match against Kevin Owens at the Beast of the East WWE Network special, which took place in Tokyo, Japan. Temporarily back on his home turf again and with the power of the Demon King, Balor was able to defeat Owens to become the champ, much to the delight of the Japanese audience, many of whom had followed him throughout most of his career up until that point. He followed this victory up by beating Owens in the ladder match at NXT TakeOver Brooklyn. After that, he entered the Dusty Rhodes Tag Team Classic Tournament, teaming up with Samoa Joe and eventually winning the whole thing. Of course, this was just a setup for his next title program, as Joe predictably turned on his partner. The two would then have a series of matches, the first of which took place at TakeOver London, where the Demon came out to the ring in full Jack the Ripper regalia, eventually getting the win after a hard-fought battle. The same happened at NXT's next pay-per-view, TakeOver Dallas, where in keeping with the theme of the night, Balor's dark side now arrived with a chainsaw in hand, hoping to massacre his opponent with it. It wasn't just Samoa Joe, of course. Finn Balor took on all comers as NXT's top dog. And by April 21st, 2016, when he finally lost the belt, he had become the longest reigning champ in the brand's history, holding it for 292 days. The title loss served a purpose, of course. Finn was being called up to the main roster. During the July 2016 WWE draft, he was picked up by Raw, being their third selection and the fifth overall. This was WWE's way of showing audiences how seriously they were taking Balor and how much star power they saw in him. During his time in NXT, he had become so popular that he had effectively carried the brand on his back, making it difficult for the company to move him up for some time. When he did make his first appearance on the July 25th episode of Raw, he did so in explosive fashion, pinning Roman Reigns clean to get a shot at becoming the first ever Universal Champion at the following month's SummerSlam. At that event, Balor fulfilled the promise the company saw in him and beat Seth Rollins to become the inaugural champ. Unfortunately for him, the celebration was short-lived. He had suffered a torn rotator cuff during the course of the match, and as a result, would require surgery. He vacated the title the next night on Raw, but promised fans that he would regain it upon his return. This return wouldn't come until the night after WrestleMania 33, a full 10 months later. Audiences had hoped that Finn would be rocketed back up to the main event scene to reclaim the title he never lost, but it appeared that during the time he was off, Vince McMahon had soured somewhat on the Demon King as a top-level main eventer. Perhaps he was worried that Balor was too injury-prone, perhaps the notoriously fickle boss had just moved on to his next flavor of the month by then. Of course, it wasn't as if Finn was buried or anything. He remained a strong upper-mid-card presence on the roster, and was occasionally even slipped back into the main event. That said, he never quite reached the same heights as he had on that first month on Raw. His next notable feud after his return was against Bray Wyatt, where, a full year after becoming the first Universal Champion, the Demon was able to beat Wyatt at SummerSlam 2017. This program continued on for a while, and at one point there was even a planned match that would see Finn's Demon persona take on Bray's sister Abigail. Thankfully, this never took place as Bray was pulled from the event at the last minute after contracting the mumps. Instead, AJ Styles took his place and gave fans a genuine dream match between the first and second leaders of the Bullet Club. Balor ended up winning that bout, one which certainly managed to live up to the hype surrounding it. The two even called back to their past allegiances by throwing up the two sweet hand sign at each other once the match was over. It was speculated by some at this time that WWE might now try and revive the Bullet Club, albeit under a different name, with the two superstars taking dual leadership roles. This didn't quite happen. Instead, Balor realigned himself with two other former Bullet Club teammates, Karl Anderson and Luke Gallows, to form the Balor Club. This stable became official on the January 8, 2018 edition of Raw, and saw the three have much success together in the time it lasted. Balor continued to prove his worth after that when he survived for an impressive 57 minutes and 38 seconds in the 2018 Royal Rumble. At WrestleMania 34, 2 months after that, he was involved in one of the best matches of the night against Seth Rollins and The Miz. He was riding the crest of a wave now, and by August 20th, the night after SummerSlam, Finn had finally earned his rematch for the Universal title, one he would unfortunately lose to the reigning champion Roman Reigns. Nevertheless, he put on an impressive effort, and by the Royal Rumble 2019, he got a chance to have another dream match, this time taking on Brock Lesnar. Lesnar won the match, of course, but it wasn't for lack of fight from his opponent. Afterwards, many believed that it was time Finn got his due and be moved back up to a more permanent main event role. This, however, didn't seem to be on the cards, something which was frustrating for the Irishman. Balor was ready for a change, and luckily for him, WWE had decided that they needed his star power elsewhere. With the birth of AEW, WWE had moved NXT to a two-hour live spot on the USA Network every Wednesday in order to compete with their competition's weekly show Dynamite. To really push back against their upstart competitors, they had decided that they needed to add some main roster star power to the show. And so, after losing to Bray Wyatt's new incarnation, The Fiend, at that year's SummerSlam, Balor reappeared on NXT TV, announcing that he would now be there full-time. This was where he was able to rediscover the edge he had lost on the main roster, turning heel and dropping the Demon King in favor of his new Prince persona, something a lot closer to the real rock and roller he had portrayed in New Japan. His first order of business was to lay out the man who had taken his place as the face of NXT, Johnny Gargano. From there, he would beat Matt Riddle at TakeOver War Games, and was soon pushed back into the title picture, getting his shot at champion Adam Cole in a match he very well may have won were it not for a distraction from Gargano, who had come back for his revenge. This sparked a full-scale rivalry between the two, which climaxed at February 16, 2020's TakeOver Portland, a match which re-established Finn as one of the best in-ring performers in the company, and saw him getting the eventual win. His streak of victories continued after this as he beat the likes of Damian Priest and Timothy Thatcher. It wouldn't be long before he was back in the title picture again. However, this time, it would be under different circumstances. The champion of NXT at the time, Karrion Kross, had gone down to injury and was required to vacate the title as a result. This led the company to book a four-way Iron Man match between Adam Cole, Johnny Gargano, Tommaso Ciampa, and Balor himself. By the end of the hour, Cole and Balor both had two pinfalls apiece, necessitating a sudden death rematch between the two of them the following week on September 8th. That night, Finn was able to pin Adam Cole to once again become the NXT World Champion, finally regaining the throne that he had lost. Since that day, he's proven why he deserves the title, putting on one of the best matches of the year against Kyle O'Reilly at TakeOver 31. This match was so hard-hitting, in fact, that both men were legitimately injured by the end, with Finn actually breaking his jaw. As it stands right now, the hope is that he'll be able to return from injury quickly. It would be unfortunate if he had to vacate the belt again, but even if he does, his stock has risen so much since returning to NXT that we are pretty sure he'll be just fine. Now, perhaps more than ever, Finn Balor has become a total package wrestler, one who is great in the ring, has a believable character, and looks like a champion. Whether he remains in NXT or goes back up to Raw or SmackDown in the future, he'll remain one of the best talents the company has to offer, and a key player in any ratings war they find themselves in. Not bad for a kid from a small seaside town in Ireland. Well, guys, what did you think of the video?